Good morning. Grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. My name is Pastor Matthias, and it is a joy to welcome you to worship here at LeRoy UMC on this beautiful Palm Sunday morning. And friends, even though we're not able to gather together in person this Sunday, we are still united together in spirit through the Messiah who sits beside each and every one of us in this time and joins us together as the body of Christ as we lift our shared Hosanna to the Christ who has come into our lives. And friends, this morning as we join in virtual worship, we went ahead and reached out to a number of folks from our church family and asked if they would be willing to help us in leading worship this morning, and we received fantastic response. And so I am delighted here at the start of the service to say that the majority of our worship service today is actually led by you, by members of our church family. And so as we prepare to join our hearts and minds together and all to worship the Lord our God, I would invite the Suter family to lead us in our opening prayer.
Good morning. We're the Suters. Please join us in the opening prayer.
Please bow our heads. Blessed One, you enter Jerusalem in a lowly state, with no horse, no chariot, no great army, but only a simple donkey. You emptied yourself and came as a servant to all. Son of David, we pray you might come to us now and be our king, that we might live under your reign this morning and lift up our own shouts of Hosanna wherever we may be. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Rock and Redeemer, shield and reward, I'll wait upon you.
into our thirsty hearts again.
Amen. Well, friends, as this is Palm Sunday, we felt that it was only fitting for us to hear together the words of Psalm 118, a passage that's very much at the center of our festivities this morning, and to hear it read gradually, kind of throughout the worship service. However, I feel that I should explain or give a little bit of context to our first reading. So this week we asked the Riddle family if they would be willing to read the first section of Psalm 118, verses 1 through 9, just to start us off. And they happily agreed. They said, absolutely. And then I suppose very much wanting to capture the joy and the fun of Palm Sunday, they sent in a very grand reading of Psalm 118. So with that being said, here's our first reading of Psalm 118 from the Riddle family.
Reading from Psalm 118, verses 1 through 9. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his love endures forever.
Let those who fear the Lord say, his love endures forever. When hard pressed, I cried to the Lord. He brought me into a spacious place. The Lord is with me. I will not be afraid. What can mere mortals do to me?
The Lord is with me. He is my helper. I look in triumph on my enemies. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in humans. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in princes.
Amen. So the bar may have been set a little bit high for future readings, but thank you so much, Riddle family. And friends, as the psalm tells us, this morning we join our hearts together to worship a God whose love endures, a God who is our refuge, and a God who reaches out to give us the gift of peace, a peace that passes all understanding, and a peace that we can always share with our brothers and sisters. And so, friends, this morning at this time, I would invite you to pass the peace of Christ with our brothers and sisters by posting a comment in the comment section of this Facebook video right now as we hear Steve Dean play.
Psalm 118, verses 10 through 18. All the nations surrounded me, but in the name of the Lord I cut them down. They surrounded me on every side, but in the name of the Lord I cut them down. They swarmed around me like bees, but they were consumed as quickly as burning thorns. In the name of the Lord I cut them down. I was pushed back and about to fall, but the Lord helped me. The Lord is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. Shouts of joy and victory resound in the tents of the righteous. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. The Lord's right hand is lifted high. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. I will not die but live, and will proclaim what the Lord has done. The Lord has chastened me severely, but he has not given me over to death. The word of the Lord.
Brothers and sisters, this morning our Savior comes to us humble and riding on a donkey. And as he comes to lift us up from the pit and to take all of the joys, all of the concerns, all of the prayers that we have to give in this time. And friends, at this time, if you have a joy or a concern that you would like us to be praying for here at the church, I would invite you to go ahead and post it down in the comments section of this Facebook video. We can all see it there. Or, if you like, our church has a new online prayer request form that you can use to submit prayer requests at any time during the week. You can find that either on our Facebook page, or it should have been sent out through the church email chain. But you can use that to submit any prayer requests at any time. Only the staff will view that, and if you'd like, we can share it with everyone, or we can just be lifting it up. Or you can also still text any prayer concerns you might have to me directly at any time. My phone number should be in the video description of this Facebook video. But this morning we do have a few prayers that folks have already gone ahead and submitted through our online prayer request form, in which we can lift up together. Marty Albert has asked for prayers for his nephew's wife, Jamie, who has been sent to New York to combat COVID. Marty, with you we lift up Jamie and all those who are battling this virus to a God who seeks to drive out sickness and pain in our lives, and who is always working to raise up healers all around us. We ask that God might walk with Jamie and might make her a blessing in this time. Lee would like prayers for the co-worker of her daughter Kelly out in Pennsylvania, who it seems was recently diagnosed with COVID and is now in the hospital. Lee, along with you, we turn in these moments to a Savior who is there for us in moments of immense struggle and hardship. We ask that Christ might reach out to bring health and to bring strength to all those who are themselves battling this virus. Jan Borium has also asked for prayers for her grandson Lincoln, who is 6 months old and this week had to be taken to the hospital as he's been struggling with allergies, eczema, and with sepsis. Jan, with you, we lift up Lincoln to a Savior who welcomes all children to come to him, to a Savior who actually says that it's to children that the kingdom belongs. We ask that Christ might draw near to Lincoln in this time, and that Christ might bring Lincoln some measure of that kingdom power that belongs to him. We also have a prayer for Rick Lones, who is battling cancer during all of this, that his spirits can be lifted up in this time, and that he might gain strength, and that his cancer might recede. Carla, along with you, we pray to a Savior of strength, that Christ might come and lend his strength to Rick and stand beside him in this fight against the struggles and the evils of cancer, and that Christ might lift Rick's mind and Rick's spirit to a place of peace in all of his battles. And lastly, Kevin Darty would like prayers for his cousin Jennifer, who had emergency surgery recently to remove a brain tumor and is now recovering at home. Kevin, with you, we lift Jennifer to a God who as the psalmist puts it, is our helper and is our refuge in difficult times. We pray that God might be that helper and that refuge for Jennifer in this storm that she faces. But friends, at this time, let us join our hearts and minds together wherever we may be as we go before the Lord our God in prayer. At the close, I would invite you also to join in saying the Lord's Prayer wherever you may be. And I would invite the Dean family to lead us in our prayer.
Good morning, church family. This is the Deans coming to you from our kitchen table. We'd like to share the prayer to the people with you.
Please pray with us. Holy God, you have opened the gates of righteousness in the city and called the righteous to come and enter. The stone the builders rejected is the one who has become our cornerstone. And the one who comes in the name of the Lord is the Redeemer who makes plain the path of salvation. Lord, you offer us forgiveness and fullness of grace this day. So may you hear every shout of joy and cry of thanks we make in the streets, and accept every struggle and anxious worry we sacrifice on your altar. Holy God, take all that we have to give you and walk with us through the gates of righteousness this day. As we pray together the righteous prayer you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Well, friends, this morning for Palm Sunday, we have two scripture readings. The first is the third part of Psalm 118, verses 19 to 26. And then our second reading is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. It's Jesus's triumphal entry into Jerusalem. But listen now for the word of the Lord, first from Psalm 118. Open for me the gates of the righteous. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation. The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. The Lord has done it this very day. Let us rejoice today and be glad. Lord, save us. Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From the house of the Lord, we bless you. And our second reading from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, why are you doing this? Just say this, the Lord needs it and will send it back here immediately. And they went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. And as they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, what are you doing untying the colt? They told them what Jesus had said and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it and he sat on it. And many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. And then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. This is the word of the Lord. Friends, please pray with me. Savior, who comes to us this morning triumphant and humble, surrounded by shouts of praise, if this message praises your name, then may it be heard clearly by your listening crowds and show the redemption you bring. But Lord, if this message fails to praise you as it should, then let its words be lost in the songs and chants of this morning. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. When Jesus arrived in Jerusalem, did the crowds shout Hosanna in joy or in distress? Now, I know that is probably a strange question to ask, especially on a morning like this. Palm Sunday is a celebration. It's one of the most important celebrations in our church calendar. It's a morning when all of the songs that we sing are upbeat and cheerful, when we wave special palm branches in the sanctuary, when our Sunday school kids parade around the church as proud parents take pictures, when we gorge ourselves on marshmallow peeps and starburst jelly beans, and when we lift our voices together with energy and with joy as we chant Hosanna again and again and again. Palm Sunday is a celebration for us. So how could there ever be such a thing as a distressing Hosanna? How could that even be a question? That's just illogical. It's a victorious, excited, cheerful Hosanna for a cheerful, joyful morning. We all know that. So why is it then that in Hebrew, the word Hosanna quite literally means save us? That's the actual translation of the word Hosanna. It means save us. Every Palm Sunday, whenever we go around smiling and enthusiastically waving palm branches, we are in fact chanting again and again, save us, save us, save us, as we go saying Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest literally means save us, God in the highest. Hosanna at face value is less of an excited parade chant as it is what a drowning man shouts to the people standing on the shore, save me! And that is so disorienting, isn't it? That does not line up with the joyful festivities that we go through this morning. It doesn't line up with anything about this morning. More than that, the translation of Hosanna challenges a lot of our assumptions about Jesus's triumphal entry into Jerusalem and the way that we picture it. Think about it. That means that Jesus is greeted in Jerusalem by crowds of people who come out to literally shout, save us, like a panicked mob or a group of people who have reached the end of their rope. And yet, at the exact same time that they do this, they do wave branches, lay down robes, and cheer as if they are celebrating the most joyful of all occasions. It is a parade when Jesus arrives in Jerusalem. We get that much right. The crowd's words, what they say, just doesn't line up with their actions, with what they're doing. So I ask again, honestly, did the crowd shout Hosanna in joy or in distress? Was Jesus's entry into Jerusalem a celebration parade or a mass cry for help? What sort of Hosanna are these people chanting in Mark 11? And more importantly, what sort of Hosanna are we chanting this morning? Now, we all know the word Hosanna. We don't just say it on Palm Sunday. We say it every month during communion. It's a word that comes to us from Psalm 118, the psalm that we've been hearing read little by little throughout the worship service. And Psalm 118 is basically 29 poetic verses written by a single individual who is giving praise to God as they testify to the whole community of believers about a time when God rescued them from a truly hopeless situation that they once faced. And you can just hear it in the testimony that they give. Countless enemies surrounded me, they say, like bees, like a blazing fire of thorns. I was chastised and punished severely. I was falling, they admit, and did not know when it would all stop. And it's in that context of hopelessness and distress that the psalmist first uses that term, Hosanna. It's the author's plea to God in that desperate moment, save me, O God. They cry out to God in despair and distress, and the Lord answered me, they tell us. I was falling, but the Lord helped me. This person is delivered by God from that hopeless, miserable situation. In Psalm 118, actually turns into a song of praise. They now tell the whole community, God raised me up and set me in a broad open place. God's steadfast love endures forever. And over time, Psalm 118, it changes and evolves. It becomes not just a poem of praise, but a whole ritual that is used by thousands of Israelite pilgrims who come to the temple in Jerusalem to give ecstatic, joyful praise to God for a time when they were rescued from distress. And more than that, it even becomes part of the Jewish people's annual Passover meal. We ourselves still use it today as part of communion, our Passover meal that we do today. Over centuries of use and repetition, what began as a poor cry for help, Hosanna, save me, was transformed into a shout of joy. And the author's original desperate, hopeless situation was transformed into an enduring reason for hope and praise. But that doesn't really answer the question that we asked of how the crowd shouted Hosanna. Hosanna may have become a joyful shout of thanks, but that doesn't erase the desperate plea that Hosanna originally was. What happens when you aren't looking back, giving thanks for distress long past, but find yourself shouting Hosanna because you are still in that dark place? When is Hosanna, save me, a joyful shout of thanks and hope? And when is Hosanna a desperate cry to God for help that you need now, urgently? Which was it that the crowd was shouting when they saw Jesus, the rumored Messiah from Nazareth, ride through the city gates on a donkey? And in uncertain, turbulent, and trying times like these, when do we sing Hosanna in praise for the peace and confident hope that we feel? And when do we pray Hosanna in distress over the fearful and difficult burdens that we face? Which is it? Somehow, Hosanna was and is and has to be both. Somehow Hosanna, save us, is both the desperate cry of people lost in hopeless distress and the joyful cheer of people who hope in God's enduring faithfulness. When Christ entered Jerusalem riding on a donkey, as Zechariah and so many prophets said that the Messiah would, there were undoubtedly people in the crowd who felt overwhelming joy in that moment. There were people who knew that, well, even if times may be hard, well, they remembered that they had seen distress before, and they knew that God had delivered them before, and they hoped that somehow God was about to redeem them again. There were plenty of people in the crowd who had every reason to give thanks. People who had homes, who had food to eat, who had families, children, and so didn't hesitate for a moment to grab a palm branch and to wave it in excitement before the triumphal one that they hoped would be God's new deliverer. And as Christ and his disciples processed through the streets, there were undoubtedly other people in the crowd who felt overwhelming fear and distress. People who were downcast, wounded, hurting, and frightened. People living under foreign oppression who had lost control of their daily lives. People who had lost businesses because of heavy taxation and a collapsing economy. People who had little, if any, reason to hope for a silver lining tomorrow. And, well, who let out a scream of Hosanna rather than a joyful Hosanna of praise. As bizarre as it may seem to us today, the Hosannas that filled the streets of Jerusalem that first Palm Sunday were a mix of praise and desperation. Because Hosanna is not only the shout of a people who hope in hopeless situations, but it is the cry of people desperate to be saved from distress, and both are in that Palm Sunday crowd. And so many Palm Sundays later, both still are. And that's okay. That's fine. There is no right or wrong way to lift up your Hosanna this morning, because incredibly, both trust in God. That's the amazing thing about Hosanna, the amazing thing about it all. Regardless of whether they found themselves in peaceful confidence or in anxious uncertainty that morning, everyone who came out to shout Hosanna shouted it because they all trusted in God. The woman who waved the palm branch with a smile on her face for the blessings that God had given her, and the downcast man who looked in desperation for a ray of light in tomorrow, both in their own ways shouted their Hosanna to the same God. Whether they were giving thanks for the ways that God had delivered them or would deliver them, or whether they were begging for help that they desperately needed, it was in God that they all trusted. Whether they came into that crowd as thankful pilgrims or as frightened psalmists, everyone lifted their eyes to a God whose love endures forever, even in loveless days. And whether they shouted their Hosanna in cheerful thanks or in a desperate plea, everyone could say, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," to the one they knew fulfilled their joy and met their distress. And that's the beautiful thing about the Hosanna that we get to lift up together on Palm Sunday. It does not matter whether we raise it in praise or in pain, in thanks or in need, in cheer or in sorrow, in joy or in distress. It is the same Hosanna that chooses to trust in the same God who is faithful and in the same Messiah that we see riding not just into the city, but riding into our lives this morning. And regardless of whether we find ourselves in joy or in distress this Palm Sunday morning, we can all shout out and lift up our own Hosanna as we trust a God who can and does save us. When Christ entered Jerusalem, how many faces in the crowd greeted him with hosannas of joyful praise, and how many with hosannas of anxious distress? So many Palm Sundays later, how many of us shout Hosanna with cheerful voices and confident hearts, and how many of us cry a Hosanna of need and anxious worry? Somehow there has to be room for both of us in the crowd. But the beautiful thing is, there is room for both. Hosanna is the chant that is there for the delivered and the beleaguered, for the redeemed and the lost. And regardless of whichever we may be this morning, or whatever we may be, it is the chant that we get to lift up together, because regardless of whether we shout those ancient words, "Save us," in joy or in distress, we all trust in the Messiah who does and has come. Thanks be to God. Amen. And friends, at this time, as a Palm Sunday people who have gathered in the streets to raise our Hosanna to the Messiah that comes, I would invite us to continue to worship the Lord through the gifts that we bring. At this time, let us have our offering. We find strength to face the day. Well, friends, before we part ways, a few final announcements, things that are coming up for the church family during this Holy Week. Announcement number one, Thursday will be Monday Thursday. We will have a short service here on our Facebook page. We'll look together at Christ's last act of service for his disciples, but that will be at 7 o'clock. On Thursday here on our Facebook page, and then that will also be posted to our church's YouTube channel afterwards, but that will be Thursday, and then Friday is Good Friday, and we will still be having a community Good Friday service. So we will be joining with brothers and sisters from the Presbyterian and Christian churches at 7 o'clock on Friday. The service will be posted here on our Facebook page and again to YouTube afterwards. But it will be wonderful for us to join our hearts and minds together with brothers and sisters from our whole community as we remember together our Lord's Passion. And then, last announcement, and maybe the most important, next Sunday is Easter Sunday. So we've been talking for a while about whether or not it'd be possible to do some sort of an in-person service, but it seems that it would probably be best for us to continue having a virtual worship Sunday. So next Sunday at 9 o'clock, we will have Easter morning worship here on Facebook, and we will also be trying something brand new. We will have communion. So our church has gone ahead and bought little grape juice containers and also wafers that we will try and deliver to as many congregants as we can this week. I would ask that if you haven't received any communion elements by Thursday, feel free to send us an email here at the church and we'll try and get some elements to you. If not, then any bread or grape juice or wine that you may have at home will certainly work. But the elements that we'll be delivering to folks will be pre-blessed, and then we will all join together during the worship service for a shared liturgy. But friends, those are the announcements. And with all of that being said, as we close out our Palm Sunday, I would invite you to hear the final words from Psalm 118, and then to receive the final blessing. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine on us. With palms and hands, join in the procession up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Now go forth into the world to join the crowd that has gathered this morning and to lift up your hosanna. Cry out to God for God to save you in your distress and anxious fear, or shout out joyfully to a God who has saved you with praise and thanks. But however you shout Hosanna this morning, go forth to trust in a God whose love does endure forever, and to trust in a Messiah who has come. And may the blessing of Almighty God be with each and every one of you, now and evermore. Amen. Friends, the service is ended. Go in peace.
Shield and reward, I'll wait upon the Lord.
soul.